blessing to see each and every one of you today. I'm actually going to go ahead and preach bilingually again this morning. So pray for me. I've been preaching through Mark, but as I'm preaching through a book, if the Lord uses another passage of scripture in my life, I get out of the routine and I go to that passage of scripture. And so that's what we're going to do today. Voy a predicar bilingüe, así que por favor que oren por mí. Estuve predicando del libro de Marcos, pero Dios me ha hablado por medio de otro texto, así que vamos allá. Let's look up Psalm 119. Psalm 119, and we'll read from there verse 75. Vamos al Salmo 119. Vamos a leer el versículo 75. Solo se va a leer en inglés. I know, O Lord, that your judgments are righteous, and that in faithfulness you have afflicted me. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning. Padre, nos acercamos a ti hoy en esta mañana. We come thanking you for your word and a place to come to listen to your word. Te agradecemos por tu palabra y un lugar donde venir a reunirnos a escuchar tu palabra. Lord, we know that we need your spirit to illumine, to direct, and to guide. So we pray for an awesome work of your spirit this morning. Padre, reconocemos que necesitamos de tu espíritu hoy en esta mañana para iluminar el texto, para guiarnos y para bendecirnos. Que así sea. We ask for this in the name of Jesus Christ, for his glory, and so that his kingdom would be spread. Te lo pedimos en el nombre de Cristo para la gloria de él y para que se extienda también el reino de él. Amén. So as we go into this text, I would like to, we're only going to be meditating or preaching from the last part of it, which is 75, and that in faithfulness you have afflicted me. El mensaje de hoy en esta mañana viene de la última parte del versículo donde dice que conforme a tu fidelidad me has afligido. Now, there's people that don't believe that God is sovereign, and there's people that don't believe that God is sovereign, even much less in affliction. But the psalmist sees God's sovereignty, and he sees that God is even sovereign in affliction. Hay quienes no creen que Dios es soberano, y mucho menos en la aflicción. Pero aquí vemos que el salmista dice que Dios es soberano en la aflicción. What do I mean by the sovereignty of God? Let's go to Ephesians chapter 1 with me, and we'll read there. Verse 1. You can either turn in your own Bibles or you can listen as I read to you the passage of Scripture. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 11. Para ver de qué se trata la soberanía de Dios, vamos a leer el libro de Efesios, capítulo 1, versículo 11. Lo voy a leer en inglés. Ephesians 1:11 says, "And we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will." So when we're talking about the sovereignty of God, we're talking about a God that works all things after the counsel of his will. Así que cuando hablamos de la soberanía de Dios, estamos hablando de un Dios que realiza todas las cosas conforme el consejo de su voluntad. So that's what we're talking about. We can also go to Romans chapter 11. You can take your Bible and turn there. Once again, you can just listen as I read the verse of Scripture to you. Ahora vamos a ver el Romanos capítulo 11, versículo 36. Lo vamos a leer solamente en inglés. Romans chapter 11 and verse 36. For from him and through him and to him are all things, to God be the glory forever. So if we're seeing that all things come from God, how can we say that afflictions are not in some way allowed by God? God, as popularly is said, is in control. God is sovereign. Así que si todo viene de Él, ¿por qué no decimos que también las aflicciones vienen de Él? Como se dice de manera popular, Dios está en control. Pero Dios está en control aún en las aflicciones. Now, when we speak about afflictions, they come through different avenues, we could say, in our lives. The first thing that we think when something goes wrong is, what do I do now? And that could be a truth, but it's not always the truth. Cuando hablamos de las aflicciones y el camino por donde nos llegan, pues lo primero que siempre pensamos es que, ¿qué hice ahora? Y sí, viene siendo una verdad, pero no siempre es la verdad. God does afflict because of sin. If you remember the story of Jonah, God said, go to Nineveh, preach to Nineveh. What did Jonah do? He went the opposite direction. And so while he's on the boat, the Bible says that God sent a storm into the sea, literally threw a storm down into the sea. Si nos acordamos de la historia de Jonás, vemos que Jonás desobedece a Dios. Dios le dice, vete para Nínive. Él dice, no, para el otro lado voy. Y Dios manda una tormenta, que Dios literalmente dice en las Escrituras que echa un viento al mar o echa una tormenta, arroja una tormenta al mar. And so we see that God sent an affliction on Jonah because of his disobedience. But the purpose of God was to bring Jonah to a place of repentance. Así que vemos que Dios aflige a Jonás porque Jonás le desobedece. Pero que el propósito de Dios es de conducir a Jonás al arrepentimiento y a la obediencia. But not all afflictions come because of our sin. Some afflictions come because God is preparing us and teaching us to serve others who may in the future go through the same thing that we're going through now. If you have a pen, you can go ahead and write it down. A good passage to see for that would be 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. We're not going to go there today. But God sometimes puts us through affliction so that we can learn how to guide others through their afflictions. Dios no siempre manda las aflicciones por nuestro pecado. Dios también nos quiere preparar y nos quiere enseñar para que nosotros también ayudemos a los demás que en un futuro van a estar pasando por lo mismo de lo que nosotros estamos pasando. Si quieren ver eso más adelante, en su casa sería segunda de Corintios 1, del 3 al 8. So we have that God does send afflictions because of our sin. We have that God sends afflictions to prepare us in order to serve and to help others. But we also see that God sends affliction so that we draw near to Him. Así que ya vimos que Dios a veces sí manda las aflicciones por nuestros pecados, que Dios a veces nos está preparando para servir a los demás, para ayudar a los demás a salir adelante, aún en medio de la misma aflicción que nosotros estemos pasando en ese momento. Pero también vemos que Dios manda las aflicciones para que nos acerquemos a Él. To see that God sends afflictions so that we draw near to Him, we can go back to the same story of Jonah. If you think about this story in Jonah, because of Jonah's sin, he is on a ship that's headed the opposite direction of where he's supposed to go. God sends the storm, and there's these sailors on the boat. These sailors come to what could be a saving knowledge of Yahweh, a saving knowledge of the Lord, because when Jonah says to get the storm to calm down, you got to throw me into the sea, when they do that, the sea becomes calm, and the Bible says that they praised Jehovah God. They praised and they offered sacrifices and made vows to the Lord, which is in distinction of their gods. So it's very possible that they came to a saving knowledge of the Lord. Why did that happen? Because of an affliction that had been brought upon them because of Jonah's disobedience. Para ver que las aflicciones también vienen, para que nosotros nos acerquemos a Dios, no tenemos que salir del libro de Jonás. Podemos ver que ahí están en la barca, Jonás ahí está por su pecado, Dios manda una tormenta, los marineros que están ahí no conocen al Dios vivo y verdadero, conocen a dioses de piedra, pero Jonás les dice, écheme al mar y se va a calmar la tormenta, lo echan al mar, se calma la tormenta, y la Biblia dice de que ellos empiecen a glorificar a Yahweh, a Dios, al Señor, que se distingue de sus dioses, que se les llama nada más dioses y no el Señor. So we can see that God, the avenue through which God sends affliction is sometimes through our sin, sometimes through the sin of others so that we draw near to Him, and sometimes for the benefit of others so that we learn how to comfort others. But now I want to see how God uses these afflictions in a little bit different, in a little bit deeper way. Hemos visto que Dios a veces, el camino por donde Dios manda las aflicciones es por nuestro pecado, puede ser por el pecado de los demás, que es para que nosotros nos acerquemos a Él, o para prepararnos y enseñarnos, para ayudar a los que pasan por tribulaciones semejantes. Ahora vamos a dar una explicación más al fondo de la fidelidad de Dios en las aflicciones. So now what we're going to see is the faithfulness of God. Because if we go back to the psalmist's words, what does he say? According to your faithfulness. According to your faithfulness, you have afflicted me. So how is God faithful, even in afflictions? God is faithful in afflictions, even when He sends afflictions because of our sin. Dios es fiel en las aflicciones, aun cuando mande las aflicciones por causa de nuestro pecado. If we have seen the glory of Christ, if we are in Jesus, if we've repented of our sins, we know that all of our sin was on Jesus on the cross. We know that He took the payment for us. So if God sends afflictions because of our sins, then what would the purpose be? Could we ask the question, well, if God has already punished my sin in Christ, then why would He afflict me because of my sin? A lo mejor si estamos en Cristo, y si estamos en Cristo, sabemos que Cristo cargó con nuestros pecados ahí en la cruz, que ahí saldó la cuenta a Dios. Entonces, una pregunta que pudiéramos tener es, ¿por qué Dios me aflige que Cristo ya pagó por mis pecados? We can say that God, when He disciplines His children, is disciplining them in a different way than the way that He made payment for our sins on the cross. You see, Christ died for the guilt of our sin so that we would not be exposed to the wrath and to eternal punishment. so that we would not be exposed to the wrath of God and to eternal punishment. Christ took our sins on the cross. He took our guilt. He made the payment so that we would not have to go to hell, so that we would not have to face God's wrath. But as we come to faith in Jesus Christ, we become children of God. And so God, by these afflictions that He sends us, has a new purpose. Hermano, no es que Dios, al mandarnos aflicciones por causa de nuestro pecado, no es que Dios esté castigando el mismo pecado dos veces. Ya que estamos en Cristo, ya tenemos otro, ya tenemos a Dios por Padre, y Dios ya tiene un nuevo propósito en las aflicciones. Nos disciplina como hijos. So now that we're in Christ, our sins have been paid for, but because of our sins, the Father still disciplines us because He has a purpose. And His purpose is to sanctify us. To sanctify us. So to see this, let's go to the book of Hebrews. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 12. Ahora que Dios es nuestro Padre por lo que hizo Cristo en la cruz, Dios manda aflicciones, pero ya que Él es nuestro Padre, las aflicciones tienen el propósito de disciplina en la vida del creyente. Y esa disciplina es para santificar a sus hijos, para santificar a su pueblo. Vamos a ver el libro de Hebreos capítulo 12, versículo 6, y vamos a leer el 14. Voy a leer solamente en inglés. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 6 says, "For those whom the Lord loves, He disciplines, and He scourges every son whom He receives. It is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? But if you are without discipline, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Furthermore, we had earthly fathers to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not much rather be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them, but He disciplines us for our good, so that we may share His holiness. All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble, and make straight paths for your feet, so that the limb which is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. Pursue peace with all men and the sanctification, without which no man will see the Lord." So we see that God sends discipline. He sends afflictions into the life of the believer because of the believer's sin, but it's not because he has something less to, or he has something more to require, or he has some another payment that is required. It's to make his children holy. It's to bring about sanctification in their lives, without which no man will see the Lord. So we see that the purpose of the Father is a good. Así que vemos que las aflicciones vienen por el pecado de la mano de un Dios soberano que es nuestro Padre. Es para disciplinar a sus hijos, para llevarlos a la santidad sin la cual nadie verá al Señor, pero no es un mal propósito, es un buen propósito. Es un propósito tan bueno que ni nos imaginamos. So we see that God's purpose in discipline is not an evil purpose, it's a good purpose. It's to bring about His glory, and it's to bring about our good. Because sin is never good for us. And He knows what's best for us. And that's what our Father wants for us. El pecado nunca es lo mejor para nosotros. Por eso Dios nos disciplina. para que nosotros veamos que el pecado no le agrada a Él y no nos hace bien a nosotros. Dios nos lleva a la santidad y la obediencia a sus mandamientos por medio de las aflicciones, por medio de la disciplina. Así sabemos que el pecado no le agrada a Dios. So that's God's purpose in disciplining His children. But what is His purpose in sending afflictions through other people that are in our life? There's many people that suffer because of others, that suffer under others and through others and because of others. Can we say that God has an evil purpose in allowing these things to happen? No. Vemos que Dios tiene buen propósito en la disciplina, pero ¿qué tal las aflicciones que vienen a nosotros, no por nuestro pecado, sino por el pecado de los demás? ¿Cuántas personas nos sufren a mano de otros? ¿Podemos decir que la intención de Dios es mala? No. Sigue siendo un buen propósito, aunque permita aflicciones de otros. So to see that God's intention is good, even in allowing us to suffer because of other people's sin, we can just continue there in Jonah. We see that because of Jonah's sin, the storm comes. But also because of Jonah's sin, salvation comes to those who are on the boat. Podemos decir, no tenemos que salir de la historia de Jonás para ver cómo Dios usa el sufrimiento que nos viene por el pecado de los demás. Jonás peca, está en el barco con los marineros y la salvación lleva a los marineros porque Jonás pecó y porque Dios mandó una aflicción. So even if we're suffering because of others, God has a good purpose in that. He's promoting our own salvation by many different ways. He's causing us to look to Him. He's causing us to fall to our knees constantly. But His purpose is good in all of it. Así que aunque estemos sufriendo a mano de los demás, el propósito de Dios es un buen propósito. Dios está obrando de una manera nuestra salvación aún en esas aflicciones. Por esas aflicciones, por el pecado de los demás, nos acercamos a Dios. Caemos de rodillas delante de su presencia. A veces no aguantamos las aflicciones y por eso acudimos a Dios. El propósito de Dios es bueno. I heard a story about a pastor who had his wife turned out to be a very evil lady. And his brothers would come to him and say, "I'm sorry, brother, that you're suffering so much." And he said, "No, don't say you're sorry. She's kept me on my knees this whole time." God uses those things. God uses those things in our life. Escuché a un hermano contar una historia de un pastor que tenía una esposa malísima y su esposa le afligía a ese hombre. Sus hermanos pastores se le acercaban y le decían: "Hermano, lo siento mucho que le haya salido así su esposa." Y él dice: no me digan nada. Por ella estoy delante de Dios todos los días, arrodillándome delante de Él, suplicando en su presencia, acudiendo a Él constantemente en todo momento. Así que es un buen propósito el que Dios tiene aún en las aflicciones. And to see this, we can go to a verse that we can probably, a lot of us could quote by memory. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. Vamos a Romanos capítulo 8, versículo 28. Y el texto lo vamos a leer en inglés de nuevo. Romans 8:28 says, "And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose." There's really no reason for me to explain this, because if you're in Christ and if you've been in Christ for a time, I have no doubt that you have wonderful experiences with this verse and that you know exactly what this verse is talking about. No tengo ni que tomar el tiempo de explicar el versículo, porque si usted ya tiene tiempo en Cristo, me imagino que ya ha tenido unas buenas experiencias con esa porción de Escritura, que usted ya sabe a lo que se refiere y hace le recuerda de ciertas cosas por las que ha pasado y que ahora usted ve el propósito de Dios en todo. Maybe this verse even reminds you of things that you've gone through, and now years later you can point to that and say, "I know what God was doing there." And maybe you don't, but you can still trust that this verse is solid truth, that God's purpose is good. A lo mejor no tiene mucho tiempo de creyente. O a lo mejor esa cosa que usted pasó todavía no sabe el por qué. Pero podemos dar por sentado, podemos estar bien seguros de que este versículo es una verdad de Dios y que el propósito de Dios en la aflicción siempre es un buen propósito. It's time for a question. Who is the one who has suffered most? You don't have to answer it at this moment. But when we're going through something, first thing that comes to our mind is, nobody's gone through this. I'm the only one. Nobody knows what I'm going through. Isn't it? Temptation that we got every time. Una pregunta. ¿Quién fue el más afligido de todos? Lo primero que siempre pensamos es que nosotros somos los más afligidos, que nadie ha pasado por lo que pasamos nosotros, ¿verdad? Es la tentación que siempre tenemos. But do you remember Job? In one day, he lost all of his children. In one day, he lost all of his riches. He lost everything in a moment. And it wasn't because of his sin. ¿Se acuerda de Job? Él perdió todo en un momento, sus hijos, su riqueza, su todo, y no fue por su pecado. He was left with his wife, but she just told him, curse God and die. She was a lot of help. And it wasn't because of his sin. His quote-unquote friends came to help him out, and they were not good helpers. He did not sin himself into the temptation or into the affliction, but he did sin in his affliction. When you see some of his responses, he wasn't right all the time. In a lot of things he was, but not in everything. Y bueno, Job se quedó solo con su esposa y, bueno, pues no le ayudaba mucho. Le decía, maldice mejor a Dios y muérete. Fue las palabras de ánimo que ella le daba. Sus amigos que vinieron, supuestos amigos, no le ayudaron en nada. Job no pecó para que entrara al sufrimiento. Pero, pues si vemos algunas de sus reacciones, no reacciona bien. Pecó en su sufrimiento. Seeing that Job did not sin himself into the suffering, we're reminded of someone who suffered much more, who did not suffer because of his own sin, and he didn't ever sin at all, not even in all of his sufferings. So Job reminds us of the Lord Jesus Christ. Pero vemos que Job nos recuerda de alguien mayor, alguien mucho mejor. Cristo. Cristo no pecó. Cristo no entró en el sufrimiento porque había pecado. Pero Cristo tampoco pecó ni una vez en todos sus sufrimientos. Él padeció, Él sufrió por nosotros. So Jesus, being perfectly innocent, the God-man, God made flesh, suffered for sinners. And He Himself never suffered once. That's why He is now our Savior. He took upon Himself our sins, and He died under the wrath and the power of the Father. And He did it for us. That sin was not His. It was mine, and it was yours. But He took it on Himself in all of His innocency to pay for the debt that we owed. Así que Jesucristo, siendo inocente, sufrió por los pecadores, y Él no pecó ni una vez, por eso Él es nuestro Salvador. Él cargó nuestros pecados y murió bajo la mano poderosa de la ira de Dios, y lo hizo por nosotros. El pecado no fue suyo, el pecado fue el mío, y el pecado fue el de usted. Pero Él lo llevó, Él llevó el pecado en toda su inocencia para pagar la deuda del pecado. I remember as a kid when I used to hear about Christ paying a debt. A debt? What debt? What are you talking about? I can understand He paid, He carried our sins, He took our load, He died for our sins, but what's all this about a debt that He paid that I did not owe? Well, you see, sin offends the glory of God. And just like when one commits a crime or offends the laws of the land, he owes something. So when we offend God, we are offending His glory. We are offending His majesty. We are breaking His law. And so we owe something. And that something is what Christ paid on the cross. De niño, yo me acordaba que yo escuchaba de que Cristo pagó una deuda que yo no podía pagar y no entendía. ¿Qué deuda? Yo entendía si decían que Él murió por mis pecados, pero no entendía eso de una deuda. Todo el pecado ofende la gloria de Dios y por eso contrae una deuda. Por eso Dios requiere el pago. Pero Cristo llevó nuestro pecado para pagar esa cuenta. So if we think of debt, trying to do an example from what has happened, recently with all the storms and everything. I have a tree out in the front yard, and thank the Lord that nothing happened to it. But let's just say that the storm, that because of my fault, because of not pruning, because of not trimming my tree, one of those branches came off and it bust a window in somebody's houses. Or let's even, Josiah's playing baseball and he breaks a window. There's a debt. There's a debt that's got to be paid. Why? Because something's been broken. Somebody has been offended. Somebody has to pay for the window. Who's going to pay for the window? Well, it's not going to be the neighbor. It's going to be either Josiah or Josiah's dad. But in the case of our debt with God, because we broke something much more than a window, we broke His law. Because of that, Christ had to step in. And He had to pay the debt that we could not pay. Because that debt is much more than a broken window. And He paid that debt so that I could go free. He paid that debt so that I could have a good relationship with God the Father. Pensando en la deuda y que el pecado contrae una deuda, vamos a suponer que Josiah está jugando al base y rompe la ventana de un vecino. Alguien tiene que pagar, ¿no es cierto? O el vecino tiene que absorber el gasto. O Josiah tiene que sacar de lo que trae ahí. O el papá tiene que pagar. Pero en el caso de nuestra deuda con Dios, no podíamos pagar. Porque habíamos roto mucho más que una ventana. Habíamos roto la ley de Dios. Así que Cristo Jesús entró para pagar la deuda que yo no podía pagar. Y Él lo hizo por nosotros. So that's what Christ did for us. He paid our debt. He's the one that has suffered much more than anybody else, because he took upon himself the debt of all of his people. Así que Cristo Jesús es el que murió por nosotros, y él ha sufrido mucho más, y él ha sufrido no por su pecado, sino por el nuestro, y lo llevó allí en la cruz. So since Christ is the one who has suffered most, if we are in Christ, how do we interpret our suffering? We interpret all of our suffering in light of the cross of Jesus Christ. Como Cristo fue el que entró y tomó la deuda, y él ha sufrido mucho más que cualquier otro, porque él llevó toda la carga. Ahora que él lo hizo así, tenemos que interpretar, si estamos en Cristo, tenemos que interpretar todos nuestros sufrimientos a la luz de la cruz de Él. So to see this, if you turned in your Bible to the last portion of Scripture, to Romans 8:28, you're probably still there. And so we'll just kind of stay there. If you look there at Romans 8:32, pues ahí mismo donde estaba, en Romanos capítulo 8, y para ver la misma verdad que estamos viendo, vamos a leer el versículo 32 en inglés. Romans 8:32 says, "He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things?" So you see how Paul interprets suffering. He interprets it in the light of the cross. Pablo interpreta el sufrimiento a la luz de la cruz de Cristo. The cross is the symbol. The cross is the surety that God is for us, even though we are going through many afflictions. So in the midst of afflictions, we should remember the cross of Jesus Christ. La cruz es el indicio de que Dios está por nosotros. Aunque estemos pasando por muchas pruebas, debemos de acordarnos de la cruz para poder decir, como Pablo dice, aquí desde el 33 hasta el fin del capítulo, lo vamos a leer en inglés. So let's see here how Paul interprets sufferings in the light of the cross. Romans 8, we've already read verse 32. Let's read 33 down to the end of the chapter. So because of the cross, Paul says, who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is he who died. Yes, rather, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? Just as it is written, for your sake we are being put to death all day long. We were considered as sheep to be slaughtered. But in all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. So because of the cross, Paul could say, I am convinced that nothing can separate us. There's no affliction that can separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Viendo las aflicciones a la luz de la cruz, Pablo pudo decir, por lo cual estoy convencido de que nada, ninguna cosa creada nos podrá separar del amor de Dios, que es en Cristo Jesús, Señor nuestro.
So I ask you today, do you know the cross? Do you know forgiveness? Have you seen that this is your only option, that this is the only way that you can be made right before a holy God? And have you trusted in Jesus? Is he now your treasure? Is he now your joy because of what he has done for you? If not, today is the day. Come to Jesus. There's no reason to wait. All of the afflictions that you've gone through, you can consider them, because you're here listening to the gospel, you can consider them as something that God is using to bring him to yourself. So come to Jesus now. There's no reason to wait.
Así que viendo las cosas así, tengo una pregunta. ¿Usted conoce la cruz? ¿Usted conoce el perdón que solamente se encuentra en la cruz de Cristo? Si no, hoy es el día de salvación. Venga a Él. Es solamente por ese medio que Dios perdona, porque es el medio que le glorifica a Él.
So if you're in Christ, how have you responded to affliction in your life? And how should you respond?
Si usted está en Cristo, ¿cómo está reaccionando? ¿Cómo ha respondido a las aflicciones en su vida?
If you've seen that the affliction comes from God because of sin, it's time to leave it. It's time to make war against that sin. Because God afflicts because sin doesn't please him. And God afflicts because he will have a holy people. So leave the sin. If you have Jesus, then you have his Spirit. And if you have his Spirit, you have a promise of victory over sin.
Si tiene a Cristo, tiene el Espíritu. Y si tiene el Espíritu, tiene la promesa de victoria sobre el pecado. Haga guerra contra el pecado, déjelo. Porque Dios lo aflige porque el pecado no le agrada. Y quiere un pueblo santo.
In all of our afflictions, in all of our trials and tribulations, we should learn from them to help others. Under the grace of the gospel, the best example of what it is to glorify God is Christ Jesus. That's why when we were studying Galatians, we saw that wonderful verse in chapter 6. In verse 2,
debemos nosotros de aprender de todas nuestras aflicciones para poder a los demás que pasen por las mismas aflicciones. Y el ejemplo mejor que tenemos es la persona de Cristo y lo que estudiamos de Gálatas 6, 2, lo que vamos a leer en inglés.
Bear one another's burdens and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. The law of Christ is his perfect example that he gave of loving God and loving neighbor. So let's take that yoke upon us. And let's be willing to help others who are suffering. This morning, I gave an example of, it's not the same for me. I've never lost a child. It's not the same for me, never having lost a child, to
come up to somebody who has lost a child and to say, I'm praying for you. I can't say I know what they're going through, but somebody who has can. Those situations are so that we can fulfill the law of Christ. We can know how to love our neighbor. We know what they need because we've gone through the same thing.
Hoy en la mañana, pues puse el ejemplo de una persona que perdió su hijo. Que esa persona que sufrió por ese medio tiene la capacidad de ayudar a otras personas que yo no puedo ayudar, que nunca he perdido un hijo. Así que estemos dispuestos a ayudar a los demás.
So God's purpose in all of his afflictions towards his people is to conform us to the image of the Lord Jesus Christ.
El propósito de Dios en todas las aflicciones para su pueblo es de conformarnos a la imagen de su Hijo.
Last, I don't doubt that there's somebody here that is suffering because of the sin of other people. You've either suffered, or you are suffering, or you will suffer.
No dudo de que alguien que esté aquí está sufriendo por motivo del pecado de otra persona. Sea algo por lo que ya ha pasado o por lo que está pasando en ese momento.
There's a word that Paul writes in Romans chapter 6. Sin will not have dominion over you because you are not under the law, but you're under grace.
El pecado no se enseñoreará de ustedes porque no están bajo la ley, sino bajo la gracia.
The main application for that verse is our own personal sin, of course. But in a secondary sense, we can say that if we're in Christ, if we're under grace, then even the sin of those around us does not have dominion over us.
Ese versículo más que nada se aplica al pecado personal de nosotros. Pero si nosotros estamos bajo la gracia, también podemos decir, no solamente que nuestro pecado no se enseñoreará de nosotros, sino también podemos decir con confianza que ni el pecado que hayan cometido en contra de mí se enseñoreará de mí.
I pray that God would bless his word today. And I pray that we would learn to think through our afflictions in light of the cross of Jesus Christ.
Que Dios bendiga su palabra hoy y que aprendamos a pensar en nuestras aflicciones a la luz de la cruz de Cristo.
Let's pray. Father, we come before you, thanking you for your word.
Padre, te agradecemos por tu palabra.
We thank you for the time that you've given us, and we pray that you would use your word in our hearts through the power of your Holy Spirit, that you would apply it.
Padre, pedimos que tú apliques tu palabra en nuestros corazones por el poder de tu Espíritu Santo.
And I pray that we would remember he who suffered more than anyone else.
Pido que nos ayudes a recordar al que sufrió más que cualquier otra persona.
And I pray that if seeing that he suffered for us, then now all of your intentions in suffering are good.
Pido que podamos ver que ahora que estamos en Cristo, todo el sufrimiento por el que tenemos que pasar es para nuestro bien.
It's in the name of Jesus that we pray.
En nombre de Cristo te lo pedimos. Amén.
Amen.